Hi everyone, please welcome to the talk entitled Exploring Billion Atom Scale Quantum Materials Using Linear Scaling Quantum Transport by Dr. Jose Hugo Garcia from Catalan Institute of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology. The instructions to the talk are the following. Please keep your microphones off during the entire presentation. We will have a session of questions by Zoom and via YouTube. Thank you very much for your attendance. Now I leave you with Professor Álvaro Muñoz Castro, which will introduce the speaker, Dr. Jose Garcia, and will attend all the questions at the end of the presentation. Thank you, Professor Álvaro.
Well, many thanks, Peter, for your nice introduction. So this time, I have pleasure to introduce to Dr. Jose Hugo Garcia, who will give us a nice presentation related to his research topic. Dr. Jose Garcia did an undergraduate in physics at the Universidad Central de Venezuela, followed by a PhD at Physics II at Universidad Federal de Rio de Janeiro, where he developed a numerical method in the real space to calculate different transport properties in different in topological systems. And after that, he did a postdoctoral fellowship at Instituto for Science for South America, located at Sao Paulo. And since 2016, he is now involved as a researcher at the Catalan Institute of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology, where he's developed his research now. So, Jose, you have time, you have the microphone now, and thank you for accepting this invitation.
Thank you very much to all of you, and specifically to the Red Latinoamericana de Fisicoquímica Teórica for inviting me and for allowing me to present this topic. So, first, I also thank you for the kind introduction. First, I'm going to tell you more or less where I am. I had to advertise a bit at my institution. In fact, I should put here, but go to the website of the institution because there is a couple of open positions for postdocs and PhD at the moment. So I am currently working at the Catalan Institute of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology, or what we call ICN2, which is at Barcelona. And it's in the mountain, around 20 minutes from the Barcelona Center, which is at Plaza Catalunya. And in particularly, this institute, the goal is to have different research groups from physics, chemistry, nanotechnology, optics, and et cetera. And we are all working together to try to develop disruptive nanotechnology applications. This is the group where I work with, the Stefan's Roche group. We are a group specialized in numerical quantum transport and numerical simulation of spin and charge properties, mainly focused on two-dimensional materials, but we also do one-dimensional materials or molecules, additive calculation, molecular dynamics, and also topological insulator and 3D materials. So the outline of the talk is the following. First, I'm going to do an introduction. It's a two here that should be here, but I'm going to do an introduction of for those that are not familiar with what is quantum transport and in general for the people that is more young. And then I'm going to speak a bit about the core of the talk, which is the linear transport methodology and how we managed to go from a general methodology or a conventional methodology that is not linear scaling to these linear scaling methods. And I'm going to then show you some examples of how these methods or what is the power of these methods and how I use them to do some of my research at the moment. All right, so let's start with the introduction. And this, as you see, will go progressively more complicated. So let's start from the very basic. Whenever you want to describe a quantum system, what typically one starts is with the Schrödinger equation, which is this equation here. And the Schrödinger equation have two inputs. One is the Hamiltonian, and the other input is the wave function at some particular time. And it has an output, which is the wave function at all the energies or all the times. Okay? So you need to, if you want to describe a quantum system, you need to find the Hamiltonian and to find a way to have the wave function at some particular time. To describe both the wave function and the Hamiltonian, to describe both the wave function and the Hamiltonian, you have to choose a basis, right? The wave function in a particular basis can be a function or a vector with some dimensionality, and the Hamiltonian is either an operator or, depending on the dimensionality, can be a matrix. So then, what kind of basis do you use to represent this wave function or the Hamiltonian? It depends on your application. I put these two names here because I find it appropriate. In fact, I recently became aware of this kind of separation, which is that you can use either a real space basis, as I typically call it, which some people call the chemist way, because chemists typically describe their systems using a real space basis. And in this basis, basically, you put a localized orbital or a localized function close to the atomic centers. Therefore, if you have a system with D atoms or capital D atoms, then you will have capital D orbitals that you need to describe that system, at least that, because you can have more orbitals than atoms. Therefore, the wave function becomes a d-dimensional vector, and the Hamiltonian becomes a d times d matrix. If you go to what is called the momentum space, or the physicist way, if you want to call it, you can use the Bloch theorem to actually, if the system is periodic, to actually make the system infinite and describe it just in terms of the atoms of the unit cell, which is the minimal cell that you need to replicate to describe your system. You can see here, this is graphene. So the dimensionality of the matrix and of the wave vector will be 2, because there is only 2 atoms. So why do you need to use the Bloch system, and how is the dimensionality preserved? Is because now you have to speak about a k-dependent wave function, that is a 2-dimensional wave function, but that in addition have a continuous index, which is associated with the momentum of the electron, or a k-dependent Hamiltonian, which is the will be 2 by 2 in this case, but it will depend on the electronic momentum. Just one thing that I forgot to say before. The Hamiltonian basically is the operator that gives you the energy of the system. So it's obvious that if you have the energy of the system, then you can from there extract all the properties that you want. What is the main problem here when you go in the chemist way or the real space basis? Is that typically your system will have many atoms, especially if it's a three-dimensional solid or a very long molecule. You will have many atoms. Ideally, for many of the descriptions, you want to approximate to 10 to the 23, or ideally infinite. So you want to assume that the system is infinite. In this infinite limit, what happens is that the properties of the system become continuous. But if you start, you have to to compute 10 to the 23, a matrix with this dimensionality here, with 10 to the 23, you cannot do it, right? It's a very large dimensionality. So you have to do something smaller. And if you do something smaller, what will happen is that the spectrum of the system will become discretized. Okay, so it will look similar. So you can see here the red curve is this particular property that I'm going to discuss, the density of states, a continuum function, and in an infinite limit. And this discretized system is the discretized limit is the this discretized the discretized version of this function is because you choose a discrete Hamiltonian a Hamiltonian with a discreteness. Okay, so why did I plot here the density of a state and where do I focus? So the density of a state is basically a quantity that tells you what is the number of states that you have from an energy in an interval of energy. So here, for instance, between minus 0.something and 0.something, there is 0.05 states, okay? So this is in some units, which is the number of states per unit of energy. Why this is important? Well, because many properties can be expressed as a function of the density of a state or proportional to the density of states. One of these functions is one of the main quantities in quantum transport, which is the conductivity. Why this is important? Why the conductivity is important? Because quantum transport is basically the science that studies how you take one particular quantity or property from a system and move it around due to the application of an external field. The main property that we typically do in the lab is we move charge as a function of, we want to evaluate how the charge moves once we apply an electric field. Okay, so the problem is that if you have a real space Hamiltonian, this charge, these electrons will move, but they will be extremely sensitive to the presence of inhomogeneities and disorder in your sample, because this inhomogeneity and this disorder will lead to scattering. And it's very important to, and then this scattering will limit the transport properties of the system. So if you have inhomogeneities, you break the translational invariance and you cannot use the Bloch Hamiltonian or the Bloch theorem to describe your system. Therefore, you can still use it, but it's very cumbersome. So the main advantage of using this real space method is that you can just replace a site by a modified site that describes the potential, and you can do the calculation as you did before you have the disorder. So real space methods are actually very suited to this kind of problem of quantum transport. Again, we go back to the problem that then you have to deal with very large matrices. And what I'm going to show in this presentation is how to deal with these large matrices. All right. So as I say before, this density of a state tells you how many states do you have. So the more state you have, the more electron you can use. And that's why it appears in the conductivity. But you can see that there is a trend here, which is that both are function, both the conductivity tensor and the density of a state are function of this delta function. And this is the delta function of a matrix minus the energy of the system. So if we want to compute either the density of a state or the conductivity, we need to find a way to compute this delta function numerically. Some of you might know that this delta function is actually not a function, but it's a distribution and it's defined as zero everywhere except in a point where it's infinite. So this is not the way that you define a function. And the proper way to define the delta function is as a distribution.
Luego la definición de la delta no hace falta que la pongas. Bueno, sí que sería bueno ponerla en la parte donde la introduce.
So, ¿cómo así? Sorry, what? Vale. So, okay, so this is the definition. Then we go to this, this is the way that I define it. So this is the correct definition when you want to do it as a functional, but you can then use this integral to understand that the way that this delta will appear in the calculation is inside an integral, okay? And then you just have to evaluate the function at that particular point, okay? So if you want to compute the trace of the delta function, you can use this thing called the spectral representation, where you just take the, you have the trace of a function of an operator, then you can just compute the trace as a sum of all the eigenvalues of that particular function. The eigenvalues of that particular matrix. Using this spectral decomposition, you can then try to compute the trace of this delta function as just the delta of these particular eigenvalues, and then you hope that at some point in your calculation, this will appear inside an integral, and then you just have to replace the wherever you see this EF by the eigenvalues of the sample. Another possibility is not do that, because if you want to do it in this way, you have to compute these eigenvalues, which involves diagonalization of the sample, exact diagonalization of this huge matrix. And if you take a reasonable size, this will take, I did an estimation, it will take around 2000 years, more or less. So another possibility is, okay, let's forget about diagonalizing and let's regularize the delta by using one of the possible regularization. The one that we typically use because of the connection with the Green's function is this, the Sarkozy Plamondon theorem, where you basically express the delta as a Lorentzian. And you arrive at the delta by taking this limit to eta equals to zero. The problem here is that then you have to invert this Hamiltonian matrix. Okay? You have to invert this Hamiltonian matrix, which is not much better than the diagonalization of your sample. It can be done to order square instead of order cubic, which is the exact diagonalization, but still it's not that good. You will still take around 27 years to do it, right? So I chose a different approach that seems very obvious, but it has some subtleties that you will see, which is just expand the delta as a polynomial, to do a polynomial expansion of the delta. If you want to do that, it's going to be similar to the matrix exponentiation. But here is the key of using the real space approximation. Because the real space basis is localized around the atomic center and the Hamiltonian matrix element depends on the overlap of this matrix. If you choose a very localized basis, then this matrix will be sparse, because the overlap between two distance sizes is going to be very small. You put a cutoff and your matrix will be sparse. So if you transform the problem into matrix-matrix multiplication or matrix vector multiplication, and you exploit this sparsity of the real space Hamiltonian, then you can do things. And this is what I did in 2015, and I recently reviewed it again in this article in this year. So this is what I'm going to explain a bit in the couple of slides. So how do you do that? Well, if the matrix is sparse, that what it means is that it has more zeros than non-zero elements. And what this means is that if you choose a proper representation of the matrix, then you can restrict the greatly reduce the computational cost of producing matrix-matrix multiplication or matrix vector multiplication. Okay, one possible representation is this called CRR, where you have three columns: one vector for the column, one vector for the row, and one vector for the matrix elements. So if you do this, you can see that these vectors are going to be basically proportional to the rank of the matrix. So in the matrix, so they will be in this case three times the number of stripes times the rank of the matrix. So that is a linear that reduces the computational cost by one order of magnitude, but by one order, because you go through a d by d multiplication to a d element multiplication. Let me close here. Because otherwise, okay. But if you then go back to the original goal, what we wanted to do is compute the trace of this delta matrix. So even if you reduce everything now to linear scaling matrix vector multiplication, you still have to do it n times to compute the trace. So you are go back, you want to now compute properties or observables, you are back to the n squared scaling. How do you solve this? By using this stochastic trace approximation, which basically what you do is you construct a random vector where the entries are drawn from this particular distribution, probability distribution that has zero correlation and variance equal to one. Zero correlation, zero means, and variance equal to one. So if you use this Hamilton, this random vector, and you compute a mean value with single random vector, what you can demonstrate is that due to this lack of correlation between the random elements, this is in the limit of infinite sides exactly equal to the trace. So you can replace n operation by a single operation and obtain the same. Of course, you will have some noise due to the random distribution because this is not going to be zero, but this noise is proportional to one over the dimension of the matrix. So the dimensionality of the matrix helps to reduce or to greatly reduce the noise produced by this approximation. So you can see here that all the pieces start to clusterize together. So now you have the linear scaling method, because now you expand the delta in polynomials, you compute the trace of this polynomial using this random phase approximation, and you use the sparsity so that this mean value is computed also in linear scale. So you get something that is m squared times n. So here the only problem is that what is this m squared? M is the order of the polynomial. So if you have to compute all the polynomials from the scratch, this is going to be like super expensive. So what we do is that we have to choose the right polynomials, or the better that we found. And the one that we found is the Chebyshev polynomials, that they are defined here, but they can also be defined as iteratively. So this is very important. It's a very simple property, but it's not that usual to have for many polynomials. This iterative relation tells you that if you compute the Chebyshev polynomial, then to compute the other, you just have to do a loop in one single matrix vector multiplication. So it's very cheap to compute, to improve or to increase the polynomial order of your approximation using the Chebyshev polynomials. So still there is another problem that we have to solve, which is the so-called Gibbs oscillation. And this is a problem that arises when you take a polynomial expansion and you truncate it. Because typically what we think is that if you increase some expansion or some function, the more the better. But that is not true. That is only true when you have a uniform convergence. But if your convergence is not uniform, then you increase the order of the polynomial and just a single part of your curve or your approximation can improve. Another can become even worse before improving. So there is no systematic way to increase the quality of your approximation in general. The Chebyshev polynomial have a property that is very interesting, which is that it is simple to derive what is called a kernel, that basically what it does is it introduces a damping factor, which is what you call it GM, that regularizes the approximation and make it and transform it or imposes an uniform convergence. So that if you increase the polynomial order, you increase and you improve your approximation of any function that you are using. In this particular way, you see that this is in A is the delta function. So you see that in the middle, it looks more like a delta function because it's more sharp and it's more tall, but then you have negative values and oscillation that are not characteristic of a delta function, but when you include this kernel, it looks more like a delta function in general. And the same happened with the Heaviside theta, which is in the figure P. And here is the combination of all these things together, okay? So if you want to compute the density of a state, which is the simple example of a quantity for transport that we are going to see, basically, you just take this delta expanded in the polynomials, use random phase approximation, and then you have to rescale, but this is not that important. But you use the random phase approximation, and you can see that this red figure here look exactly or look very similar to the previous density of a state that I showed you in the infinite limit. So this show you that all this approximation, when done properly, can capture some of the physics of the system. You will see this in the example section better. And then it is important, but I'm not going to discuss this, that because you are doing three kinds of approximation, you need to understand well that you need to converge the number of moments, that you need to converge the system size, and that you need to converge the number of random phase approximation. Depending on the conversion, you can go worse or better, etc. And then with this methodology, you can use it to describe many different phenomena, in particular to compute transport of any quantity under the transport induced by the action of an electric field of any physical quantity that you want. You just have to use what is called the Kubo formula, where all these methodologies used to replace the Green's function of that appear in the Kubo formula. You see the Kubo formula is G, 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 and then two operator, O and J, where J is the current matrix, O is the operator, H is Hamiltonian, and G is the Green's function. So you can do all the same, all that I explained, but for the Green's function. This, we have a review on this on physics reports that we did this year. And there we show how to do all I did for the density of states, but for this Kubo formula. It's basically the same. And you can show that you go from 1 billion years to 1 month. And this is 1 billion instead of 2000, because here there is a multiplication of two of this singular operator, while in the density of state is only one. So this become more critical here to make it linear scaling. And then, going back, this is just a representation or a generalization of what I showed you before, which is the simplified Kubo formula. And this is the Kubo formula when you express it using the Chebyshev polynomial. So you can see that it's very simple. You just now have the Chebyshev polynomial, the current density operators, and then a coefficient. And now we go to the section of examples. I think I took like 20 minutes. This is the section of examples. It's going to... It's not to discuss exactly the physics, because the physics is very complicated in general, but to show you something, to show you the essence of how to apply these methodologies. So in this particular case, it's a collaboration we did with the experimentalists at ICN2. They construct a device based on graphene on transition metal dichlorogenides, where they have multiple contacts and they want to evaluate how the spins flow in this device due to the action of a magnetic field and the spin orbit coupling field. And what they do is that they build the device that you see here, and they measure a resistance associated with the spin currents. They obtain this curve here, but here is the important part, which is how is the experimental measurements compared to the numerical method that we have. So you can see that using this numerical method, we can do a very good approximation of the experimental measurements, not only as a function of the carrier density, but also as a function of temperature, which is something that very few methods can do. And then this is the second example that I'm going to briefly show, which is that the typical way that we start is just by having a particular system. In this case is the transition metal dichlorogenide in the 1TD phase. we build a model and fit that model with using first principle calculation. For that, we have all the methodology based on the symmetries of the system. And once we have the fitted model, we compute this fitted model will be a Hamiltonian. This Hamiltonian will go to the machinery that I already discussed. And then I can compute the conductivity tensor, which is what you can see here. In this particular case, what we found is that this the direction, this is a spin conductivity tensor. The direction of the spin will be oriented along this particular angle, minus 56. And then after this paper was published, two experimental papers came out almost simultaneously, where they found that the orientation of the spin was describing an angle of 50 degrees, 54, and while ours was 56. So you can see again that even for not only for charge, but for a spin, you can use this method to actually to a point where you can compare directly with experimentalists. And finally, there is another way, another extra information that is important for this kind of method is that we actually have, we're involved in a very large supercomputing project where we actually demonstrated that by following this numerical approach, we can take advantage of the massive parallel environment of very large supercomputing and show that this method was almost linear scaling with the number of cores up to around 60,600 cores. So that means that the scalability of the method is very good. So the more computer you have or the more processor you have, that means that you can go to larger system and you can describe better the reality. And this is the conclusion. Basically, it was a talk about the methodology. It's about the Kernner polynomial method that is an efficient way to overcome this exact generalization and matrix inversion. And I want to share the message that you can start by this complex, by these typical algorithms. And if you think a bit on how to make it more efficient for a particular application, you can go from something like this cube scaling to something that is linear scaling. And that's it. Ah, well, I think I put, no. Ah. No.
Jose. For your nice presentation. So now we have some time for questions. So please, if the audience wants to ask something, you can raise your hand and open your microphone. Or if you want, you can put your question in the chat of the Zoom platform. So I have one question, Jose. How much time take the, how much computational time you need to have for run this kind of calculation like the ones that you show us in the in your paper, in this paper that you mentioned here?
So it depends a lot of the on the scale of the interaction present in your system. In this particular case, it took, I did it in my, in the computer of this, on the, in the computer of the center, which has 40 cores, and it took like a week.
Like a week, yeah.
But in the case of the TNDs, because the interactions were very weak and you needed to have a very large system to actually resolve the fine structure of the interaction, I did it using 1,000 cores. And in 1,000 cores, it took like 3 days.
So it works well. So if you have the computational resources, you can use this methodology for very large system at the end.
Yes, it was 40 million orbitals, and it took 3 days in 1,000 cores.
Great.
So what kind of element do you include here in this calculation? So you can include all the elements like gold, element where you need to include relativistic effects.
So that's a good question. So what we do, we need to choose a localized basis to describe your elements. So in principle, you can include anything as long as you know how to model it. But there is no limitation from the methodology point of view on what kind of basis do you use. You don't even have to use sparse matrices, but if you don't use them, it's very heavy to compute. In principle, there is no limitation on the model.
Great. What about this kind of non-covalent interaction? For example, if you have some surfaces at the Van der Waals radii distance, not too covalent. So
no,
you think this methodology?
Yeah, I mean, the methodology is general, but typically all these effects are complicated to capture from the first principle perspective. So if you want to do like the density functional theory, then these effects might not be captured. If you don't capture it, and then you fit a model that then goes into my code, then you won't see the effect. So all these problems will have to be dealt at the first principle stage. But once all those problems are addressed there, then the models derived from that should be the methodology using the model derived from that should capture all the effects.
Great. Thank you. So any other question? I will look for the YouTube. No. Yeah, it seems that we don't have more questions. I don't know if you want to give some last word in this.
I want to advertise again the center. So go to ICN2, Google ICN2, because our group, I think we are hiring like 2 people. Go to Google Catalan Institute of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology. I think there are several calls for people. So they are hiring from theory and also from experimentalists. And you can also message me in my Twitter if you want to do the question directly, or if you want to understand better a particular part of the methodology. And if you want to go into the details, you can look in this particular, this one here. Everything is in here. It's like, this is the insignia article of the group. All the 20 years of linear scaling quantum transport methodologies are very well explained in this paper. Better explained than what I can do in this presentation. So you have a question, you can go there. If you can, then you can ask me.
It's a review or?
The review and it's open access.
Paper or? That's good. Perfect. Excellent. So I will check again for if we have more questions. No? So thank you again for your nice presentation, Jose. I hope that everything is going well at your side. You live in a very nice place, actually. So it's good to have the possibility to go out and to do a kind of trekking, doing that kind of stuff. So thank you again for support our network, and thank you for your presentation. And for the audience, I extend the invitation for the next webinar that we will have in 2 weeks according to the schedule. So, and also remember that in September, we will have our Twitter meeting based on these different posters that you can submit. So just spread the word and join us in that amazing adventure. So thank you again for your attendance. Thank you, Jose, again. And see you in the next session. Bye. Okay.